The Miami Dolphins entered Sin City as underdogs, but the Sharps in Vegas thought the Dolphins would actually play the undefeated Raiders close. They were right, but they were also correct in stating that the Dolphins wouldn't win. The Dolphins battled all day and surprisingly forced overtime when they really had no business being in a position to do that. Things didn't go their way and the Dolphins fell to 1-2. One of the worst things that came out of this game was the Dolphins, like they historically do, underutilized a number of their most talented players. There's plenty of suitors responsible for the Dolphins not putting their most dynamic playmakers in the best position to succeed. You can go with the offensive line not allowing the offense to run any sort of play that takes more than 3 seconds. Or, you can point fingers at the normal and very common setup the Dolphins have with their co-offensive coordinators approach. Regardless of you decide to blame, you're going to be right. The absolute worst part of this completely avoidable circumstance is that this is so Miami Dolphins. The Dolphins have had very good offensive players only to not understand how to use them properly. From Mike Wallace to Kenyon Drake, to Lamar Miller, no matter who the coaches are, they always find a way to handle talented players as if they're Rubik's Cubes that have been lit on fire. They don't know how to maximize their very obvious attributes and those players eventually leave. We're far from that reality. But is there really any reason, at the moment, to think that the co-offensive coordinators will magically be struck with common sense? No. No, there is no reason to think that. Here's the list of guys from Sunday game that had so much more meat on the bone. Salvon Ahmed. Miles Gaskin didn't get the start. Malcolm Brown did, which rose my poor man's people's eyebrow. It wasn't really a huge deal because Gaskin was still used the most of any running back with 13 carries for 65 yards with 3 catches for 9. What was very curious to me was why wasn't Salvon Ahmed used at all? He didn't record a carry or a catch. In fact, I'm not even sure if he was on the field for a single play. He dressed because I saw him standing on the sideline, but I don't recall him being on the field at all. But why? Why is a guy who is as fast as Ahmed not on the field being put in a position to get the ball in space? Is it because the Dolphins coaches think he's a liability as a blocker? If that's the case, that's something I can buy. But in his 23 snaps from last week, I don't recall him being awful or anything like that. Ahmed is very shifty in space and has very good hands as a receiving threat. The Dolphins made sure they threw the ball short pretty much all day against the Raiders, so you'd think that Ahmed's abilities would have been something to use to your advantage. But nah. Why do that? Why do that when you can just have Brissett scramble around and throw at guys' feet when he gets in trouble? I just think Ahmed and Gaskin for that matter could have been more involved in the passing game, especially when the offensive staff had less than 0% confidence in the offensive line to give Brissett enough time to throw downfield. It just doesn't make sense to me. Will Fuller. I don't know how many targets Fuller had during the game. It felt like he only had a few, one of them being the deep ball he got assaulted on at the end of overtime. Fuller's debut for the Dolphins ended with him having a 3-catch-for-20-yards day. Not great. Not great at all. Fuller is a guy who has world-class speed, so you'd think you'd send him downfield as often as you can and take that top off the defense that I keep hearing is so fun to do. That classic Brissett to Fuller connection down the field never happened, and Fuller was reduced to being Darius Thompson. He was brought down to the level of being a jag, just a guy, and let me tell you, that's not what his one-year $10 million contract states that he is. He's a guy that you can send on deep crosses, or post routes, and of course the 9 route. Now I know that the offensive line was once again bad, and because of their badness, they didn't allow Brissett to be able to sit back in the pocket and wait for Fuller to get behind the defense. But still, why can't the illustrious co-coordinators have enough brainpower between the two of them to figure out a smart way to getting him the ball so that he can run a little bit after the catch? I wish I knew, and I hope it changes immediately. It sort of has to if this offense wasn't to accomplish anything. Jalen Waddle. I don't know how many targets Fuller had during the game. It felt like he only had a few, one of them being the deep ball he got assaulted on at the end of overtime. Fuller's debut for the Dolphins ended with him having a 3-catch-for-20-yards day. Not great. Not great at all. Fuller is a guy who has world-class speed, so you'd think you'd send him downfield as often as you can and take that top off the defense that I keep hearing is so fun to do. That classic Brissett to Fuller connection down the field never happened, and Fuller was reduced to being Darius Thompson. He was brought down to the level of being a, just a guy, and let me tell you, that's not what his one-year $10 million contract states that he is. He's a guy that you can send on deep crosses, or post routes, and of course the nine route. Now I know that the offensive line was once again bad, and because of their badness, they didn't allow Brissett to be able to sit back in the pocket and wait for Fuller to get behind the defense. But still, why can't the illustrious co-coordinators have enough brainpower between the two of them to figure out a smart way to getting him the ball so that he can run a little bit after the catch? I wish I knew, and I hope it changes immediately. It sort of has to if this offense wasn't to accomplish anything.